how to deal with complex nitrosamines. The nitrosamines risk assessment starts in step 1, which is the theoretical evaluation of risk, and is then followed by step 2, which is the confirmatory testing in case a risk is identified in step 1. Let's say your API is a secondary amine and you have identified a potential risk for nitrite contamination in one of the excipients used in the formulation. There might be the possibility that the API amine is nitrosated, generating its corresponding nitrosamine. Since such a nitrosamine would be formed during the drug product manufacturing, we cannot justify its elimination through a purge argument. So now, what is the next step? Two possible approaches have been used by the industry for the next step. One of them is moving on with analytical testing. But this option takes a long time and is extremely challenging, especially when we think of nitrosamines with such low limits. Hence, the other option is confirming if the nitrosamine is actually mutagenic. In silico systems are available to predict the mutagenicity, and the structure-activity relationship of nitrosamines is constantly being researched and refined. However, there may be cases when there is not enough information for the risk to be mitigated this way. Based on ICHM7, when this is the case, we can either apply a control strategy or we can choose to perform the Ames test to confirm the mutagenicity. But is it worth it to perform the Ames test? If the result is positive, you would either need to control it anyways or follow up with in vivo tests. That's correct, but there is a high probability that complex nitrosamines behave differently when compared to small nitrosamines. For a nitrosamine to be mutagenic, it generally needs to be metabolized to generate the diazonium ion, which then alkylates the DNA, potentially leading to mutations. But for this to happen, the nitrosamine needs to fit into the enzyme cavity that will metabolize it. Small nitrosamines are generally metabolized by CYP450-2E1, but larger nitrosamines which do not fit this enzyme may undergo a different pathway, such as metabolism by other enzymes, which would lead to a different biological response. A recent paper has shown that due to different reasons, including steric hindrance, complex nitrosamines can be less potent than small nitrosamines or even not mutagenic when they are unable to alkylate the DNA. So performing an Ames test in this case has high chances of demonstrating that a complex nitrosamine is actually not a risk. But now, let's imagine that this is the same situation for 10 other drugs that you produce. Does this mean you should develop an analytical procedure or perform the Ames test for all these nitrosamines? This would be a huge investment of time and resources, so hopefully not. Well, what is the option then? If mutagenicity assessment is the path you take, then there is a consortium which can help you avoid repeating Ames tests that others have already conducted, and this is through data sharing. If a company joins the consortium, it donates the data it already has and then gets access to Ames test results done by other companies for other nitrosamines. Hence, a scenario that initially seemed overwhelming can turn out to have a much positive conclusion. Yes, there are many challenges to get there, and this nitrosamines topic seems to be full of them. But these are what makes science evolve, and if we work together and help each other, science will advance in a much higher speed.